Spring has finally sprung, and I hope you're able to get out and enjoy it. I don't think there's a better painting to talk about than Botticelli's Primavera, which is in the Uffizi in Florence. And often when you go to the Uffizi, you can't get anywhere near the painting. It's so famous, and the room that it's in is always absolutely rammed, which is a shame because you need to spend a long time on it. It's a highly complex, cerebral painting, and I really hope that in this talk today you can learn some new things about it. So let's think first of all about the history of the period. We're talking about Florence in Italy in the 1470s and 80s, and at this point the Medici family were pretty much in control of the city. So by this point the Renaissance had fully burst out into the century in a meteoric kind of way. And Florence was at the centre of this cultural revolution. It was a hotbed of activity. And the Medici family, who were bankers, they were extremely wealthy, they were really quite amazing patrons of the arts. And they influenced countless other families to use the arts to show off their own cultural sophistication. And what ended up happening in the city was that churches and monasteries and palaces and libraries were all built up across the city. Sculpture was commissioned, paintings were commissioned. All of this was to reflect the patrons' successes, allowing them to kind of achieve their own immortality through stone and panel and oil paint. And while this was happening, a completely new type of subject matter grew out of this. Now, while the palaces remained overwhelmingly full of Christian art in subject, slowly as the century progressed, there were new fashions for new types of art, portraiture being one of them. And this very much reflected patrons' interest in themselves and their successes, but also was copying styles from ancient Rome. And history painting was another important subject matter. And for us today, mythological subjects began to kind of creep out in the 1460s and 70s. Now, artists were, of course, at the cutting edge of all this cultural innovation. And they were armed with an ever-increasing knowledge, which was brought to Florence in books from across the globe. Now, this guy is called Cosimo il Vecchio de' Medici, Cosimo the Elder. He was the elder member of the Medici family who really helped to kickstart this cultural movement. Now, he had grown up with only three books, but by the time he was 30, his collection had reached 70 volumes. Now, just bear in mind that in the 14th and 15th century, books were rare and expensive treasures, and it was hard to get your hands on them. But he would send scribes out all over the world to bring back knowledge. And through these books came the concept of Neoplatonic philosophy, which I'm going to talk through in a minute. And in tandem with this came a colossal drive to renew Greek and Roman civilization through the arts. There was this desire for Florence to be the new Rome. It was to be at the apex of all civilization in this modern world. And the Medici family were really spearheading this movement. Now, the image of Cosimo comes from this painting. It's another one by Botticelli. And it's supposed to be an adoration of the Magi. And you can see that Cosimo Vecchio is standing in for one of the Magi. This is a completely new type of Christian painting. It's not really about the Magi at all or about the Christ child and the Virgin Mary. It's really a celebration of the Medici family. And when you go through it, you can see countless portraits of Florentines. And the painting really is dominated by portraits of the Medici family. It's really quite extraordinary that this was happening. Now, really important for Botticelli is this concept of Neoplatonism that I mentioned just now. So let's have a think about what it means. The Greek philosopher Plato had come to the fore in the Renaissance thanks to the translation of all these ancient books that were being brought into the city. And Neoplatonism was an attempt to blend Plato's philosophies with Christianity. And a key facet of this concept coming from Plato was the issue of harmony and ideal beauty. And Botticelli really picked up on this. This whole environment was something that Botticelli himself was submerged in. So he'd got to know the Medici family well. He joined Neoplatonic groups that were found by the family. And this, by the way, is him on the right-hand side in yellow. It's in the same altarpiece that we saw just now that he himself painted. So he put a portrait of himself in the Adoration of the Magi. There he is down on the right-hand side. Let's just think a little bit about who he was, where he came from. He was born, well, we don't know when he was born actually, but it was some point between 1444 and 1446. And his name is a nickname. It actually was his elder brother Giovanni's nickname, and it means little barrel, apparently from an unfortunate resemblance, so the story goes. And Sandro, the younger brother, our Botticelli, also got this rather unfortunate nickname as well. And he was apprenticed to a really fabulous artist, Fra Filippo Lippi, who was one of the top artists in Florence, very close to the Medici family. And as you can see from this gorgeous Madonna, Child and Angels, which is also in the Uffizi, at the forefront of Lippi's mind was elegance and beauty and the power of the line. And this is something we're totally going to see with Sandro Botticelli. Now, in the early 1480s, just before La Primavera was painted, in 1481 to 82, several Florentine artists, including Botticelli, painted the side walls of the Sistine Chapel for Pope Sixtus IV. So the Sistine Chapel had just been built. Take out Michelangelo's Last Judgment, take out the ceiling by Michelangelo, because these were not there at this point, and see those panels that are running down the side walls on the left and the right. They're scenes from the life of Christ. They're frescoes, actually, not panels, sorry. Scenes from the life of Christ and from the life of Moses. And these artists were sent up to Rome as part of a peace treaty between Florence and Rome. It's really interesting that already by this point, art is being used for diplomatic reasons, but that's another story. Botticelli painted three of these scenes, and we're not going to focus on them today. But it was when he returned from Rome, went back to Florence, that he started painting these mythological works that he's most famous for today. So we're going back to that altarpiece, the Adoration of the Magi, and we see this rather pompous looking man on the left, Lorenzo il Magnifico, he was called. How about that for a name? It means, of course, Lorenzo the Magnificent. And he was Cosimo the Elder's grandson, and he was right at the heart of the Neoplatonic Academy in Florence. And even in this picture, we've got him next to two humanist philosophers. There's Pico della Mirandola and also Agnolo Poliziano. Now, at this point, roughly when the altarpiece was completed and Botticelli was about to start La Primavera, who was back from Rome, Lorenzo il Magnifico negotiated a wedding for his cousin, another Lorenzo. He was called Lorenzo di Pierfrancesco de' Medici. And it's this second Lorenzo who was probably the patron of our painting, although some people think that it might have been Lorenzo il Magnifico. So this was in 1482. And Lorenzo il Magnifico negotiated the wedding between his cousin Lorenzo and a girl from the Appiano family. Her name was Semiramide. Now, this negotiation took over 3 years. It was a really, really important marriage settlement because it bought the Medici family political and very lucrative commercial connections. So, the painting was thought to have been commissioned by Lorenzo Pierfrancesco for his new wife's bedchamber. This is really important, the location of the painting, to celebrate the wedding. It's absolutely vast, by the way. For those of you who haven't seen it, it's over 2 by 3 metres. So it's really huge. And it's thought that it was to fit in the upper part of Semiramide's bed. Can you imagine having this above where you sleep? I mean, it's really quite an extraordinary thought. There's so many greats about this. It's without doubt the largest mythological painting from the early Renaissance. And by the way, alongside the portrait, this idea of the large-scale mythological painting was such an innovation in the 15th century. And Botticelli was completely at the forefront of it. He wasn't the first. There were some brothers called the Pollaiuolo brothers who were working with mythology a little bit earlier, but Botticelli really ran with it, and it's just such an exciting moment in the development of the history of art. So we're going to go through the figures that we can see in this painting. They all come from a mix of sources, and Botticelli would have learnt about these sources through his Neoplatonic academies. We can see Lucretius in here, we can see Horace, Ovid, Seneca, Virgil, all these ancients. Texts coming into Florence, Botticelli learning, the Neoplatonists learning, and he's mixing all of these ideas into his paintings, La Primavera. By the way, the name Primavera, meaning spring of course, was not given to the work for another 100 years, so it wasn't titled that until a little bit later. So let's go through who these nine figures are. We're going to start on the left-hand side, and we find here Mercury, the god Mercury. He's usually known as the messenger god, but he has a slightly different role here because you can see he's got his caduceus, his staff, with which he is dispelling the winter winds. You can see the clouds just at the top of his caduceus, which he's kind of swirling around. And this is something that Virgil talks about in the Aeneid. Next to him, we find these totally sublime three graces. And these three graces represent chastity, beauty and love. And then in the middle, we have got Venus, and we're going to come back to her quite a lot. And to Venus's left stands Flora, who's throwing rose petals from her skirts. And both Lucretius and Ovid tells us that Flora was born through a metamorphosis. And it was the touch of the warm spring breeze, the god Zephyr, that we can see on the right-hand side, that caused the nymph Chloris, that we can see in between the two of them, to metamorphose into Flora. So you can see Zephyr, the wind, grabbing Chloris, and flowers are pouring out of Chloris's mouth as she changes into Flora. So this is the moment of metamorphosis. So what are all these figures doing? Okay, I've already said that it was for a marriage chamber. So I think we can look at this as an allegory on marriage. I hasten to add that countless books and papers have been written about this painting. We don't definitively know what it represents, but the argument I'm going to put forward, I think, is the most compelling, the most believable, and I think it is one big allegory on marriage. So let's go back to the figures. Let's go back to Mercury. Could he be an allegory of Lorenzo il Magnifico? Lorenzo il Magnifico negotiated the marriage and created a favorable climate, just as Mercury here is dispelling those winter winds so that la primavera, so that the springtime can happen. And it was Lorenzo who chose a wife for his cousin with the desired qualities of chastity, beauty, and love. And there are those three graces of chastity, beauty, and love. When we look to the figure of Venus, we see that there is this plant growing behind her. That is myrtle. And myrtle is a plant that represents sexual union. And above her, we see Cupid, Venus's son, and of course the god of love. Cupid here is blindfolded, reminding us that love is blind. So Venus represents sexual union, but crucially within the state of marriage. And we know this because she is clothed. She's not naked, and pretty much all the time we see Venus in art, she's represented as naked, but not here. So here she is representing a happy sexual union within a good marriage. And the figure of Venus in this painting becomes the kind of ultimate goal. She is the one who looks out towards us. She is the one who is engaging with us. She's the figure that Semiramide should aspire to. And this is emphasized by the fact that she is the highest figure within the painting, as though she's standing on a plinth. So then we move across to the right of the painting, and we can look at this scene with a little more clarity now. And yes, I bet some of you are beginning to feel a little bit uncomfortable, because Zephyr, the wind, is representing the bridegroom. He represents Lorenzo di Pierfrancesco de' Medici, and Chloris represents the virgin, Semiramide, and Flora represents the woman that Semiramide is going to become after her wedding night, fertile and above all pregnant. And you can see how Flora is also looking out at us. She is someone else that Semiramide needs to aspire to. It's critically important that this young girl from the 15th century in Florence gets pregnant. I mean, it's pretty tough on Semiramide. I'm certainly not sure I'd want to be pounced on that Zephyr in a hurry. And for her to have to look at this each time she goes to sleep is putting really desperate pressure onto this girl. Could it perhaps be that Lorenzo is saying in this passage, yes, the wedding night is going to be difficult, it might hurt, but from it you'll gain so many riches, the riches of motherhood. Now, you can see that Flora is spreading fertility all over the place, an indication, of course, of the offspring that she is to bear. And by the way, Botticelli painstakingly followed the classical texts. He went as far as painting the same flowers that Ovid mentions. And this is the slide that I just want to show you. There are over 500 different types of plants here, herbs, spices, all of which are recorded from nature, not just the ones on the ground, but also the ones on Flora's clothes. And they all have symbolic meaning to them, themes to do with the Garden of Venus, to do with sexual desire. And then when we look in the upper part of the painting, oranges are just filling the trees. Now, oranges were a symbol of the Medici family, so this is entirely relevant. But also, if you look at the trees above Chloris, you can see how there's no fruit. But above Flora, there is masses of fruit. So these oranges also represent the fruit of the womb. They represent fertility. If you look behind Zephyr, you can see the laurel bush standing for Lorenzo di Pierfrancesco, the bridegroom. And the same can be said for the figure of Mercury. You can see laurel bushes behind him representing Lorenzo il Magnifico. Now, if we go back to the figure of Venus, I just want to think about this painting in a Neoplatonic context. So let's look at the composition. It seems very much inspired by what was known as the Sacra Conversazione. These were religious scenes that were popular in the Renaissance. It means the sacred conversation, such as this kind of painting. In fact, this hadn't actually yet been painted by the point that the Primavera had been painted, but it just gives you a good idea as to what the Sacra Conversazione was. This is a San Zachariah altarpiece painted by Giovanni Bellini, and it's in Venice. And you can see here that it is a depiction of the Virgin and Child surrounded by saints, standing in front of an apse. And if we go back to our Primavera, you can see that Venus is almost like the figure of the Virgin. Look at her colours. She's wearing red and blue. These were exactly the colours that we see the Virgin Mary wearing. And then the figures around her are like the saints, and Cupid above her could perhaps be an angel, or maybe even the Christ child. So this suddenly becomes really fascinating. Is this a Neoplatonic way to connect the goddess of love with the Virgin Mary? And after all, the scriptures talk about the Virgin Mary as the ultimate symbol of love. This really becomes a distinct possibility. And when you look at other paintings by Botticelli, you can see exactly the same connectivity going on between ancient sources and Christianity. Now, I just want to finish off by focusing on the extreme beauty of this painting. Now, I mentioned earlier that Botticelli's master, Fra Filippo Lippi, was just the most amazing artist when it came round to the elegance of line, the poetic nature of line. And you can see in the details that I want to show you that Botticelli really learned from him. I mean, look at the tilt of Venus's head and this sort of balletic way she holds her hand. I love this diaphanous material which falls down on either side of her face. This is something that he would have learnt from Lippi. And it can be seen even more prominently in this pretty mesmeric flowing drapery around the legs of the Graces, just kind of fluttering in the wind. It's exquisitely elegant. Look at Flora. She's so gorgeous, just completely abundant with flowers, flowers in her hair, around her neck, on her dress, creeping all over her. I mean, even her sleeves, you can see on the left-hand side, they look like leaves. And look at her hands, just flinging rosettes all over the place. And actually, I love this slide because you can see these three different hands, splayed fingers that are touching flowers, touching material, reaching out. It's so sensuous. And I mean, come on, are these the three most beautiful women ever painted with pretty incredible hairdos? I mean, the one on the left is just impossibly beautiful. Can she be real? Well, no, she can't. And actually, this is the point. This painting is not to be real. This is not like the other works that you would see in the early Renaissance. It is an ideal to which the men and the women of the Renaissance were aspiring to. It's completely different, this whole painting, from anything else that we have seen in the Renaissance so far. It's flat. It's all about the surface. It's about the decorative imagery. It's almost Gothic in a way. And if we think about what else has been going on in the Renaissance at this time, we find paintings like this by the great artist Masaccio, The Trinity. This is all about perspective, depth, rationale, order, harmony. Masaccio was also working with emotions, anatomical accuracy. But Botticelli really is not interested in any of this. This is a shallow, two-dimensional, flat image. It's much more like the frieze that you would see on a Roman sarcophagus or maybe even a Greek vase. It's kind of devoid of any depth. And it's really odd to think that by the time Botticelli had painted La Primavera, in the very same city, Leonardo had already completed this Annunciation. This is from 1472 to 75. And he was working on his very famous Nativity. This is a drawing of the Nativity that Leonardo did in 1481. Botticelli was entirely apart from the norm. He was going against the grain. And, well, I think that this painting is simply one of the most beautiful of all time, multi-layered and complex and thoroughly fascinating. So as you can see, Botticelli's Primavera is a highly complex painting filled with layers upon layers of meaning. And while today in the 21st century there are some quite uncomfortable themes with regards to gender, in the 15th century in Florence it would have been a tour de force of innovative thinking, and it brilliantly represents the intellectual timbre of the city. It was such an exciting place to be. And if I could time travel to any point in European history, I think I might just go back to the 1470s and 80s in Florence. So I do hope you enjoyed that and learned something new about the Primavera. If you'd like to listen to any more of our videos, please do visit our YouTube page. And for more about the company Artscapes, visit www.artscapesuk.com. Thanks so much for listening.